decorating, cooking, and sewing. She was determined that I know all things domestic. I have been described as a domestic engineer, aka Martha Stewart, Betty Crocker, and others, so she accomplished her goal. She loved coming to my house to enjoy eating things that she didn't make and to sleep in the French bedroom that she called hers that was decorated with the furniture we brought back from France. She loved all things outdoors, camping, fishing, gardening, mowing the lawn on her riding lawnmower. Yes, she had her own, had to be her own. Now this is where she and I differ. I did not inherit that gene, but my kids love doing those things with her. My parents had quite the banter back and forth. She pushed, he resisted. She was outgoing, he was shy. He would always say, though I loved her from the first time I saw her, she wasn't really interested. He would ask her out, she would turn him down, until the day that he sat with another girl in church, and from then on, she wanted him too. Today, January 29th, would have been their 70th wedding anniversary. My husband and I gave them a party for their 50th and for the 60th, and at least 2 years in advance of their 70th, Mom told us, better start planning the next party. She wanted it to be the best one yet. One thing about my mom, you never really had to guess what she was thinking because she would just tell you. And just like recently when I was talking to my dad at the hospital about reuniting with my mom in heaven, I said, you know the first thing she's going to say to you is, I am not kissing you with all those whiskers. You need a shave. As I was growing up, my dad spent most of his time in the garage, working on cars or building things. In order to spend time together, I hung out in the garage with him, as did my brothers. I got my love of cars from him. He was always buying and trading cars, working on cars, talking about cars. You get the idea. We love cars. My favorite from childhood were the Cadillac and the Thunderbird. Denny remembers the Thunderbird. He borrowed it, brought it back so shiny, I've never seen that car look so good in my life. A few years ago, my dad had me do some research on his male relatives to see the age at which they lived to be. His goal was to live to the age of 94, to be the oldest living male on the Eckerd side of the family. He was well on his way. January 10th would have been his 91st birthday. He was healthy and strong, mowing his yard, cutting limbs, building a workbench, sewing quilts, etc. Yes, my mom taught him to sew years ago, and they made quilts together, and he carried it forward even after she was gone. He also loved riding his bike with his friends. He did that for years. They rode twice a week, at least 7 miles each time. He had been wanting a new recumbent bike for a while, but with my mom's medical expenses, he always put her needs first. So a few months after she passed, he called and asked what I thought about him buying one. I immediately said, yes! My dad never bought anything for himself. He always bought everything my mom wanted. Of course, always with no as the initial response when she would ask, but always yes in the end, just to drive her a little crazy. So he and my brother Mark test rode bikes together to find the perfect one. Drove to Texas to get it and brought it home. He was so proud and excited about it. Being a part of the bike club with his best friend, Carl Kuhlman, was one of the biggest blessings in my dad's life. He always looked forward to the days they rode together, and at times it gave him a much-needed reprieve from the responsibility of caring for my mom. The last 5 years of my mom's life were a struggle, but my dad held to his wedding vows to love and care for her in sickness and in health. If you knew my dad, you know he was a man of few words, especially if my mom was around. Because we all know my mom was a woman of many words. After she passed, I got to enjoy a side of my dad that I had never seen before. He became quite the chatty Cathy. I guess when you have to hold your tongue for 70 years, there's a lot you want to say, and he did. He was relaxed and enjoyed the freedom to do the things he wanted to do, including talk about how much he loved my mom. You might be wondering why there's only one urn box for my parents' ashes. Since they have been together more than they have been apart, I knew they would be happiest together. Although, I know my mom would be saying, Kenneth, move those skinny knees, you're poking me. Before we proceed, I just wanted to let you know that particularly my mom did not want any sad or funeral type music for this occasion. They both love the church classics, as do I, but not for this day. So I just wanted you to know the songs you'll hear today are meant to be upbeat and somewhat reflect their happiness. One very special note, we were trying to figure out how to include my brother Daryl in this day, and just last week, God gave us a sign. We discovered, at my mom and dad's house, a cassette simply labeled Daryl's Band. Believe it or not, the one and only song on the tape that he sang lead on was the one you'll hear today. All the words don't necessarily reflect my parents' life situation as they were devoted to each other, but just the fact that we were able to include Daryl in such a way seemed perfect, as it would have been their 70th wedding anniversary. And the song is Happy Anniversary, Baby. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I know a lot of this, Alicia's going to be cracking up at because she's part of this, but I'm the talker and she's the quiet one. And I went off to college, and Michael and Caitlin had a little different experience with Grandma and Grandpa, so I wasn't really there for them, but I know some of the things will be the same for them too. And something that's not on this paper, but I walked in here, I had totally forgotten when we would come to church with Grandma and Grandpa, because we came all the time when we were little, Grandpa would always take his white handkerchief out and hand it to Grandma, and she would fold it up and make it into these two little rolls that were like babies tucked in a bed, and it had the little babies and the little thing. I tried my whole childhood to make that babies in the bed. I could never do it. Every time we would get to church, we'd sit right over there, and Grandpa would give us his handkerchief so we could make the babies. So that, I just thought of that whenever we got here. But we spent a lot of time with Grandma and Grandpa when we were little, but that's because we wanted to, not because we had to. There are a few things I'll never forget, and I've incorporated them into my life. We loved dressing up and having fancy tea parties. Grandma and I, the jewelry, the outfits, the hats, the teacups. When I was small enough to fit in the back of the closet of her bedroom, she had it totally empty, except for some fairy lights and a small table. We would squeeze into the closet and have tea parties with round cheese crackers. And I didn't get to use a closet with Maddie, but we started having tea parties before she started too. And for many years, Grandma would even come over and play tea parties with her when she was little. Maddie has her own teacups and her own tea sets. Then there was the outside, the greenhouse, the gardening, the mowing. I think the mowing thing definitely got passed down because I call it my lawnmower too. And you know, we know Michael and the grass, so. She always knew the names of every plant and taught me all about gardening, from starting seeds in the greenhouse to the final tomato harvest. I loved going to the plant nursery to pick out flowers for the front porch. I still choose my own plants and change out my flower beds for the summer and the fall every year. We also plant a nice sized garden, mostly from seeds. I know the names of all the flowers and bushes and trees, and everyone thinks I'm crazy. I thought that was normal for everyone to know that stuff. Evidently not, but Grandma made sure that I knew. I also loved feeding the fish back when they had the pond. I was always amazed how they could live all winter and not die. I don't have a pond, but Maddie has goldfish in her horse water tank outside. They remind me of Grandma, and one of them has even been out there for 4 years. Grandpa was always busy with a project in the garage. He would cut out shapes and benches and shelves for us to paint out of wood. Most of the time it was always hearts, and I never asked him why. I don't know if hearts were Grandma's favorite thing. I was little. Maybe stars were too hard to cut out. I don't know if anyone knows why he always cut out hearts. But I'd always want to build something, and so he would bring me a pile of lumber and hammer and nails, and I always tried to make a box or a house. But the nails were always too long. I'd hammer them in crooked. They would stick out the side, and it never looked right. But I always wanted to try again and make it better next time. So Chris and I do a lot of home improvement and construction projects around the house, and we even drug Austin into helping Maddie, Chris, and I to print a plan and build her chicken coop from scratch. When the family moved to Washington, D.C., and I stayed in Oklahoma to go to Oklahoma State, Grandma and Grandpa always had an open door and a plate of chicken strips for me to come home for the weekend. She was there for us when Austin and Maddie were little and I needed help or just a break when my family was gone. And she would sleep over at my house so we could have coffee with cream and sugar in the morning before she had to go home. I'm thankful for so many great memories and the relationship she had with Maddie, and I'm also happy for all the life lessons I'm able to pass down. And I got the car thing too, and Uncle Mark and Grandpa rebuilt my very first car in the garage. My job was to detail it, and it was totaled when we bought it, so it was very caked in Oklahoma red dirt. But so that was really special to me that they would take the time for, you know, 4 or 5 months to rebuild this car for me whenever I was a kid. And I had it all through high school and all through college, and it was great. But I'm really happy that Grandma got to pass quietly, you know, in peace, because I was there with her for rehab. I would come over to the house. I would send her every kind of book she liked to color, because she does not want to color animals, only flowers. So, you know, Oklahoma City ran out of that real fast, so thank heaven for Amazon. But she did so much for all of us. She deserved to pass. And I'm glad Grandpa got some time of freedom on his own. He was always quiet. We were always a little scared of him. When we were little, Alicia was like, yep, run. But I got to see him whenever I'd go see Grandma and everything, and help him at the hospital and bring him eggs and everything. So it was good that I got, you know, we got a little bit more time with him. Thank you.
I did a solo act, made up my own rules. Then you came along and changed my point of view. Oh baby, what am I gonna do? Just look at me, looking at you. I can't believe the things I'm looking forward to. Would you believe I'm thinking about a two-car garage and a two-story house? A couple of kids we can brag about. Give me a two-tone Chevrolet and too many bills to pay, and your two arms to make me happy living that way. If we don't get to Paris, it won't break our hearts. We'll just pack up the kids and go to Yellowstone Park. I want a two-car garage.
Imagine me and you, I do. I think about you day and night. It's only right to think about the girl you love and hold her tight. So happy together. If I should call you up, invest a dime, and you say you belong to me. Ease my mind, imagine how the world could be. So very fine, so happy together. Toss the dice, it had to be. The only one for me is you, and you for me. So happy together. I can't see me loving nobody but you for all my life. When you're with me, baby, the skies will be blue for all my life. Me and you, and you and me, no matter how they toss the dice, it had to be. The only one for me is you, and you for me, so happy together.
Remember when you were there, when I didn't care for anyone but you. I swear we've been through everything there is. Can't imagine anything we've missed. Can't imagine anything the two of us can't do. Through the years, never let me down. You've turned my life around. The sweetest days I've found with you. Through the years, I've never been afraid. I've loved the life we've made, and I'm so glad I stayed right here with you. I can't remember what I used to do, who I trusted, who I listened to before. I swear you've taught me everything I know. Can't imagine needing someone so. But through the years it seems to me I need you more and more. Through the years, through all the good and bad, I know how much we had. I've always been so glad to be with you. Through the years, it's better every day. You've kissed my tears away. As long as it's okay, I'll stay with you through the years.
Happy anniversary, baby. Got you on my mind. Happy anniversary, baby. Got you on my mind. For you. When I look back, baby,
much in love. You need a little help from
above. Ways. Well, before I begin, and I'm going to be brief as well, I think that Patty and Natalie has done an excellent job. I mean, no one can tell the stories like a family member, and you two did excellent today. I want to kind of do it from a pastor's perspective, if that's okay. And it's not any different than the way that you guys presented it, because Wanda and Kenneth were just very, very precious to me. But we are going to have an open mic at the end of me speaking, and it's here at the front. Anyone that would like to come up, and we'd ask that you be brief. We don't know how many of you will come up. Be brief, and we have sanitized the mic, and you can back off from it. Don't touch it. Back off from it. And it's an omnidirectional. It'll pick you up loud and clear. So if anyone would want to come up and say something, we encourage you to do that. And then the honor guard is going to have a special presentation at the very end. Well, needless to say, I'm going to miss Kenneth and Wanda. I really never did get over losing Wanda, because, as it's been said, Wanda was the vocal one, and always knew what she was thinking, because she told you what she was thinking. But I really miss both of them, and it's a little bit of adjustment for me when you've known someone and gone to church with them over 50 years. Well, certainly there's a relationship that is established there that you don't forget. But listen, the greatest relationship that Kenneth and Wanda had was their relationship with the Lord. And I got up this morning just thinking about the service and some of the things that I was going to share. And Psalms 116:15, I use this a lot, but it says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord are the death of his saints." And it just reminded me exactly where they're at. They're in the very presence of Almighty God. COVID certainly not, or pneumonia is not affecting Kenneth. And all the pain that Wanda has gone through, there is no pain now. And they're in heaven, and they're enjoying something beyond what you and I can even imagine. And I'm grateful for that. And again, that doesn't take away from the grieving process and the fact that we miss them, and we miss them dearly. In Romans 14, verses 7 through 9, it says, "None of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died, and he lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living." That's an encouragement to me, because he certainly was the Lord to Kenneth and Wanda while they were here, and now they're in his very presence, and certainly they're having a great time. So I know that Patty, you and Steve and Mark, I know this is a very difficult time for you, but really it's important for closure. And I know that Kenneth had a real hard time with that whenever Wanda passed, but he just wasn't ready for it. And as Patty had said, and I talked with him at different times, he just felt like he couldn't do it. Well, they're gone now. We can do what we want. And that's, I want to tell Wanda that when I get up to heaven. I'll tell you, heaven, it will never be the same with her there. If she's anything like she was here on earth, heaven will never be the same. I'm sure she's cracking jokes and all kinds of things in heaven. You know, there's a lot of things that we do visualize whenever people get to heaven. And I just know it's going to be a joyous place where people are going to have a lot of fun, and it's going to be like a big family reunion. But, you know, there's a lot of things that we can be thankful for. And I jotted down some of the things here that we can be thankful for. I'm just thankful for the number of years that God gave Kenneth and Wanda. As Patty said, he would have been 91 the 10th of January. And I talked with him about that, and we were all looking forward to that. And, of course, it didn't happen, but nonetheless, he can have his birthday in heaven. And with Wanda, I met, she was one that I found very, very easy to love. I've always kind of loved people that were somewhat controversial. And Wanda could be that in a very, very loving way. I mean that sincerely, in a very loving way. But I'm just so thankful for the part that they played in my life. And you know, I was thinking of the heritage that they're leaving behind to the family. What a wonderful heritage. You got lots of wonderful memories, but certainly you knew where Dad and Mom was going whenever they passed and they left this world. We know exactly where they're at today. One thing that we could never doubt is Kenneth and Wanda's relationship with God, and also their dedication to Him. But I want to say this as their pastor, also to this church. I meant, when you have gone to a church from the time that it was established and until the time of passing, and for a pastor being me that was here during all that time, it was very special to me. And there's so many things in the way of our relationship with Kenneth and Wanda that I never looked at them as just a member of the church, and I never looked at them as someone that was just a friend. To me, they were family. And we had talked about that at different times as well. But they attended church here from the very beginning. Kenneth was one of the first deacons or board members, board of directors that we had here, and he served for over 30 years. And Kenneth was very faithful. He was a man of wisdom. You know, I knew them and knew him well, but I didn't know his Bible reading and the great knowledge that he had of the Bible. And me and him was talking one day, and he was telling me all these stories in the Old Testament and everything. I thought, I'm the pastor, and he knows more than I know. I didn't tell him that, but it just encouraged me that I wanted to learn more, because he was quoting books and whatever in the Bible and things that were there. But listen, Kenneth and Wanda were very active in the church here. For those that are here and may not know, Wanda used to sing specials in the church. Matter of fact, her and Aline Howard, I think, at times would kind of join together and they would sing a special. But more than that, both of them were very active in the church. And different events that we had and whatever. I know whenever we bought the building across the street, it was a taco factory at that time, but it used to be a skating rink. I was living, of course, I graduated from Choctaw, but I was a part of going there skating. Then it became a taco factory, and then we made a deal that we could buy that because we needed more room. But the renovation on that was tremendous. I meant there was a lot to be done. People walked in and thought, this place will never change, but it did change. And I'll tell a little story in a minute here about what Wanda said to me after it was all done. I'm glad she didn't tell me before, but anyway, after it was all completed. But all of the men of the church, we worked on this. We didn't borrow any money at all in order to do all the renovation. It took us about 3 or 4 years to finish all the renovation. But Kenneth was there anytime there was work that needed to be done, along with a lot of the other members. So, you know, it was exciting to see them grow as I grew with them and with the congregation. And I know it's already been said, I mean, you could be around Kenneth for a long time and he would say very little unless you would ask him a question. And then the answer was very brief. It wasn't like some big, long, you know, answer or whatever. But Kenneth was, he was a very quiet person and didn't always just say a whole lot. But now Wanda, she was a different story. Like I said earlier, you never had to wonder what Wanda was thinking, because Wanda would say it. And I know every year, this was, it was so funny to me, but every year, if finances were available, all of our workers in the church, we bought them a gift card. It would be like at Logan's or one of the steakhouses or someplace. And there was one year we missed it, and boy, she came up to me and said, I want to know where my card's at. And so I explained to her, and she was okay with it, but I had to... I had to explain that to her. Well, Kenneth and Wanda, you know, to my knowledge, they were here. I knew them. We attended church together prior to starting the church here. So I knew them and the family. I never did know Steve and Daryl that much, but because you guys were already grown, but I knew Patty and knew Mark. And I knew Mark could eat a whole lot. Amen. Because I'd use him at the house and I would work him. But anyway, in all the years that I've been here, I've never, ever heard Wanda or Kenneth say, I think we're going to leave the church. This is what Wanda would say. She says, I don't care who comes or what goes. I'm here till the end. And her and Kenneth certainly were. And they exemplified that in their life as well. So they stuck to it. You know, we had some real hard financial times back in the 80s when, the oil crisis came and whatever. There were a lot of people had to leave, get jobs other places. Kenneth and Wanda, they stayed and they stuck it out. And that's what Wanda said that they would do. Listen, whenever I look at their lives, they're the kind of people you'd want in your church, that any pastor would want in their church. And Wanda and Kenneth, they were certainly that with me. And then all the wonderful memories that they leave behind. I know I'm looking more at the family because these are maybe things I'm going to share that the family doesn't know, but you may know as a congregation because I'd pick on them at times. But I started thinking about all the different ministries. Wanda was a born comedian, and she didn't even have to try. I mean, she'd say things, and I'm thinking, where in the world did that come from? And I'd be laughing, and she's just as straight faced as she could possibly be. But there was an occasion, one of many occasions, but on this occasion, we used to take the workers when we were much smaller. We used to take them out to eat on Christmas, and it just so happened Wanda rode with me and my wife, and so we're on the way, and really you don't have to say anything, Wanda will say it all, and so she's telling me about everything's going on and whatever, and she asked me, she said, do you know that we got a waterbed? I'm thinking, a waterbed? She said, yeah, and I said, well, how's that working? She said, not too good, and I said, well, why? And she said, well, here's the thing. She said, when Kenneth gets in the bed, it's okay. When I get in, it elevates him up so high he gets a nosebleed. And I'm thinking, where in the world did she get this, you know? And so that was just one of the many, many stories. And she would always get upset if we ever talked about food or we were eating or whatever. She would say this, and you probably heard her say this as family many times. She said, I don't understand this. Kenneth, this little skinny leg guy, that's what she called him. And she said, he can eat everything he wants and doesn't gain a pound. And I can look at it and gain 5. And that's kind of the way she looked at things. Listen, both of them were tremendous cooks. And I think she taught him how, because after Wanda couldn't cook as much and whatever for like the seniors, then Kenneth started making the beans and cornbread. And man, I mean, he had it down and down pat. And I used to just go over to the seniors across the street there just so I could eat beans and cornbread. And so there's just so many things about them and stories that I know that you have. But one that was really funny to me, and it just really caught me off guard because I didn't expect this out of her, because this was early on when she had a gallbladder surgery. I don't know how many, it could have been 25 years ago or whatever. And I'm in there listening to the doctor explain to her all the procedures and whatever. This was before laparoscopic type of surgeries. And so he's explaining, now this is what we're going to do and this and that and whatever. Going to take your gallbladder out, you're going to feel better and whatever. And I'm listening to all, I wouldn't have interrupted the doctor. I'm just listening and whatever. And then when the doctor got through, she said, well, she grabbed her belly like this because she was heavy, kind of heavy, well, overweight. And so she grabbed her belly and pinched it all up. And she said to the doctor, she said, listen, while you're in there, you think you could do something with this? And I'm thinking, where in the world did she get this? And I don't remember the doctor what he said, but his reaction wasn't one of, other than a real, faint look upon his face. And two, I remember when Mark was younger, I know When we started the church, I think Patty was about 13, and Mark would have been, what, 10? Maybe 10 or 11, 12, something like that, or 10 or 11. And I asked Wanda, I didn't ask Ken, I just asked Wanda, Wanda, can I use Mark? There's some things I need to do at home, and I'd like to use him. And I said, I'll pay him and pay him well. And I said, I'll even feed him lunch. And I said, can you tell me what he likes to eat? And she said, just get a slab of bologna, that's all you need. And two pieces of bread, and that's all you have to feed him. Now, I don't know that I just fed him that, but nonetheless, I can tell you that Mark, no doubt he ate good. Look how tall he is. He's tall as a tree. And let me give you one last thing here. When we were building across the street, and we spent almost around $400,000, and we used our money to do what we did so we wouldn't have any indebtedness on the building. And if you'd walked in, I mean, we did everything in the world just to get the smell of tacos out of the building, you know, everything that they, all the grease off the floor and whatever. And, you know, I never knew what Wanda really thought. I knew Kenneth was always there helping us and whatever. But after it was all finished and we had the grand opening, and it was, I'm at the building, it's still beautiful, the building is, but 14,300 square feet, and it had a cafe in the back for the youth and a gymnasium and an auditorium and a kind of a eating area. What do we call it? Not a cafeteria, but in the front there, a dining hall and bathrooms and all that. And she looked at it, but she came to me and she said, listen, Pastor, I want to be honest with you. She said, when we bought this, she said, to me, it was nothing but a money pit. And I think, I'm glad she didn't tell me that before we started on this building. But she said, you being an architect, she said, now I can see what you saw. And then she patted me on the back and said, you did a great job. Amen. And it wasn't me doing the great job. It was what everyone else did in their part of doing what they did. Listen, Wanda several times, and I'm going to close here in just a moment, but Kenneth and Wanda's greatest desire was that they'd be able to see their family in heaven. And I think you guys have positioned yourself to where that's going to happen. They wanted their family to be in heaven. And what family wouldn't? And I think that they would want me to say that today. Wanda and Kenneth, they knew how precious life was, and they knew how precious that their children and grandchildren are and will remain to be. But, you know, like James said in the book of James, he said, we know not what shall be on the tomorrow. What is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time, and then it vanisheth away. Well, I was thinking this morning, you know, 91 years sounds like a long time to most of us. But for the younger generation, it sounds like eternity. But 91 years really isn't that long when you think of eternity. And we know that's where they're at today. Because life is so precious, I think we ought to make every moment count. And let's give our flowers before our people or our family and friends pass away. Let's give it before. I'm not saying literally flowers, but just showing the love. And when I'm hearing these grandkids here, when I hear Natalie is one of the grandchildren say what she did, and you guys were over there all the time having fun, those are very special memories. They really are. You know, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:8, it says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So again, today I have absolutely no doubt where Kenneth and where Wanda's at. And one of these days I'm going to go see them. And I've always told, Wanda's always reminded me, she said, every time I hear you talk on faith, you always say you're going to live to be 120. Well, I'm shooting for that. Now, whether I live that long or not, be between me and God, but nonetheless, I want to make every moment count. You know, when we face things like this, one of the most important things that we can have is relationships with each other. And I know Patty, you and Mark and Steve, I mean, you got a wonderful family. You got grandkids and those that kids. You got grandkids too, but are going to be there to encourage you. And you guys are going to make it. Everyone makes it somehow, some way. I've had people say, you know, time is a great healer, but Jesus Christ is the greatest healer of all. And when we put our faith and our trust in Him, you're going to find that everything changes and the grieving process becomes much easier. And everyone grieves when they lose a loved one that they love. Everyone does. But you'll make it through these five steps, I promise. And some of you already have, to the place of just knowing that all is well. And that's a wonderful thing. Here's what I want to share with you, just a scripture, three scriptures that I close with this morning. And that's the words of Jesus. These has always brought great comfort to me, and I use them in every funeral that I do. But it's John chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. He said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." He says, "I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you," he said, "I'll receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." That's where they're at, and I'm going to go see them one day. Amen. All right. I'm going to have an open mic now. Those of you that would like to step forward here, and you can stand back from the mic and just very briefly share something with us. We would love that. And don't be bashful. David, you was thinking about it.
I'm just giving everybody a fair chance. Good morning. My name's David Haas, and I'm probably one of the most fortunate ones to have known Kenneth and Wanda for almost 34 years. I am the one and only son-in-law. Some of you who attend the church here, you've probably heard of me before. If it was Wanda describing me, usually either to my face or to others, "He's the most handsome, he's the most good looking, he's whatever." Yes, and I'm so fortunate because, again, I'm married to Patricia. So think about it. I'm the only son-in-law. So if I reach back to a story or two in the past, when we were dating even, I'm Catholic. Oh, he was the best looking. No. She never said that. But we had some discussions on that. But just a quick story besides from that religious conversations, which we had a few of, which was great. I loved it. I love both of them so much. But I was of the era which, when my parents went with our grandparents and everybody else, when you're finished eating a meal, family's together, it's time to clean up, the kids pitch in. And I did a lot of dishes, whether it was in Minnesota or Florida, wherever we were visiting some relatives. Did a lot of dishes in my life, along with my sister and other cousins and stuff. That was just the way it was. So again, when Patty and I were dating, my apartment, we had Kenneth and Wanda over for dinner, and we finished eating, had great conversation, getting to know them a little bit and everything else, and I started to kind of get the dishes organized and everything. And I was putting a dishwasher, I was going to wash them, wasn't that many, so on and so on. And Wanda came over to the sink area there, and I was standing there talking with her and stuff. And next thing you know, she puts her finger in the water and stuff. She goes, "You know that's not hot enough." And I was like, my first thought is, I've been doing dishes a long time. I'm good. Whatever. Anyway, she was just commenting and stuff. So then she washed me. I'm like, yes, ma'am, because I grew up, yes, ma'am, yes, sir. Washing, cleaning, rinsing, that kind of stuff. And then I remember she kind of reached over and she goes, "Are you rinsing those in cold or hot?" And I'm like, "Hot water. I got it. You know, I didn't say it that way. I was probably more like, "Yes, ma'am, yes." But I'm thinking, who is this lady to tell me how to wash dishes? Whatever. Also the same lady, that several years later, when my mother passed away, great conversation. Took me aside, basically, and said, "I'll be your mom. I'll be there for you. Come to me anytime. I'll support you just like your mom would. You can call me mom. Think of me as your mom." It's the kind of person she was. Kenneth Eckert, first impressions, we've already said it. Quiet, shy, but Mr. Fix-It, Mr. Car Guy, Mr. Whatever. I grew up a Shady Tree kind of kid. My dad taught me brakes, changing oil, those kind of things. Got it. Whew. Next level when you come into the Eckert family. Next level. Which gained my confidence because I was like, what a guy I can do the struts on the minivan. Okay, I got this. Reading. Didn't have the internet then, right? Didn't have YouTube. Reading. Oh, people get killed if they do that improperly. No problem. I've got Kenneth Eckert on the hotline who will guide me through any of that kind of stuff, as he did, whether it's changing a U-verse, he and Mark doing the car. Mark's now my sensei. I have to go to him for car information. No problem. He's awesome. But the confidence was always there to do anything and everything. I was never really concerned. Of course, cars got too smart for both of us. But still, just what a guy. And if it wasn't just guiding me through it at my own house or over the phone or something, questions, bring it over. If it's really difficult, again, it's like, let's get Mark involved. We're going to lower Michael's Mustang 4 inches. And so I'm the typical father. Why are we doing that? Whatever. We're going to do it at Grandpa's house. Mark's going to be there. We got this. Those guys are experts. And I don't know what age it was. I don't know when he stopped. He didn't stop. Again, quietly, but he's the same type as well. Want to be involved. You know, it's all of us. We'll get down there. We'll get low. We'll get dirty and everything else. Well, he goes, let me try. You know, he takes a hammer, does whatever. He gets right involved. And then you watch him around the garage, move him kind of slow or whatever. He might trip over a jack. You don't want your father-in-law or your dad to fall. But he was still engaged, still involved, wanting to swing something, wanting to make something. As you saw in the video there, he can build anything. Yeah. He can build it. He can dream it. He may not be saying something. Because we found in cleaning the house a lot of sketches, a lot of things he would draw, a lot of things he would think about. Very well organized, very much a person in numbers and drawings. That's him who he was, like an engineer, but a technical type all his life, very sharp. So just two more things and I'll get off here. Something happened last night in this church that hasn't happened in a long time. Kenneth and Wanda slept together. Not quite a waterbed joke, but they slept together. That's cool. Very cool. Very cool. Lastly, I guess really, so I'll get out of the way. Kenneth Eckert, like I said, quiet, but you mention something, you say something. Kind of a last impression for me. Came to help me a few months ago on a project at my house. My garage isn't perfect. I got it. I got a small workbench. I've got a saw over here. I've got whatever kind of stuff. I need to hammer something. I'm like, oh, let's take it over here. Let's get over here. So we're putting a vice grip on the edge of the saw, you know, where the board is on the surface of the saw area there. Vice gripping this, doing that. And he goes, David. I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. This is how I do it. Whatever. It wasn't, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks later, probably sooner than that even, get a phone call. I think it was from Mark. He goes, hey, Dad built you a workbench. And if you get an Eckert product, I can take the ball peen / sledge, whatever, and I can pound on it and not think twice. But Mark called me and said, hey, Dad built you a workbench. Do you want it? And I was like, what? I didn't even know he was listening. I didn't say anything. He just recognized that I could use a workbench. So long story short, he made a couple little modifications. He even painted it. I don't know if Mark helped him with that part of it, but the two of them together, I'll never look at that the same. What he got? He got a vice. I didn't have a vice before. I got a vice on there. So just thought of everything, and I'm so blessed. And again, I get the best blessing of Kenneth and Wanda by being so lovely, or, you know, married, happily married, to the most beautiful woman, Patricia. So they're with me every day through her and through all of you. So enough of my rattling. All right, thank you.
Amen. Hey, David, I'm not sure, but I think they're arguing in the box. I saw it move. All right, anyone else before the honor guard comes? Amen. Okay, I'm going to turn it to the honor guard for their presentation. want to thank the Honor Guard for their presentation. And to you, thank you so much for coming. Now, the family will be available to visit with them in the vestibule here in the auditorium. You feel free to do that. We do have a meal prepared for the family across the street and any friends that you'd want to come as well. And when you go over across the street, if you want to drive or you can walk, but go in the south door. It's in the kind of the middle of the building, and that's where the place is that you're going to be eating. So listen, God bless you. Be mindful of each other. Call one another. Check on one another. And make sure all is well. Amen. You're dismissed, and God bless you so much for coming and being here.